Hi everyone, this is Brett Lonsdale from Lightning Tools. First of all, just a warm welcome to the webinar this afternoon. So we're going to be going through content aggregation with the Lightning Conductor web part. So you're going to learn how to use the Lightning Conductor to aggregate from SharePoint lists and libraries. We're also going to be able to aggregate from some other different types of apps, such as Planner and OneDrive and Teams and so on as well. And we'll also get into some of the external content that we can aggregate from also, such as Jira and Salesforce. So first of all, I'm just going to do a very quick intro to Lightning Tools, just so you know a little bit about us as a company. And then we're going to dive straight into the product. We're going to have most of the hour here touring the product in a live demonstration, and we're going to be doing that inside of SharePoint, also inside of Teams, and we'll also be touching on Viva connections as well and how to use the product there. So that quick intro. So as mentioned, I'm from a company called Lightning Tools. We were founded back in 2007. And during that time, we've been building products that extend the capabilities of Microsoft SharePoint, and of course, nowadays, Microsoft Teams and Viva as well. We are headquartered in Leicestershire in England. We also have an office over in Orlando, Florida. And it's through those two locations that we serve our customers worldwide. So we've got around about 2,000 active customers using some of our products, which you can see here. So we've got a portfolio of different tools, so not just the content aggregation tool, the Lightning Conductor that we're going to be looking at today, but we also have products that help you with permissions management and permissions reporting as well. So something key for us to be considering if we're going to be looking at Copilot anytime soon. We've also got a discussion board tool, which can work inside of SharePoint and also in Teams, that improves communication with inside our organizations. We have a number of products that work around form design as well. So the Lightning Forms product, and that accompanies the document generator as well. And we've also got some list automation or even form migration tools, which will help you from migrating from things such as InfoPath and other types of form technologies over to Lightning Forms. And then finally, we've also got some data integration tools as well that allow you to connect to different data sources and build charts around that content or also reports. So these are all, of course, available on our website for you to take a look at. But today is all about the Lightning Conductor and the content aggregation tool. So we're going to be diving into that. So what we're going to start off with, for those of you that are perhaps new to the product, we're going to have an overview of what the product is. That's going to be mostly demo, as I mentioned. You'll see how to do some basic aggregation, and then also we're going to be taking a look at some of the more advanced types of aggregation that you might want to do, and that's not necessarily changing the different types of data sources that you're going to aggregate, but just getting more advanced into some of the different techniques that are available to you that you can use the Lightning Conductor for. So we'll be having a walkthrough of all of those features, and also some of the brand new features that we're going to be launching this month. So hopefully we've got some existing customers here that are already familiar with the Lightning Conductor. You'll be able to see hopefully some of those new features towards the end, and also hopefully pick up some of the other tips and tricks as we go through the Lightning Conductor in the demo, because quite often people use the Lightning Conductor for one specific reason, serving a particular business need, but there's lots of things that you can use this product for. So hopefully you'll get some ideas from some existing features that the product offers. So first of all, just a few benefits of using the Lightning Conductor. So the idea of content aggregation dates back quite some time, all the way back to the sort of 2007 era. Microsoft at the time, they created a content query web part, which was used inside of SharePoint 2007. And it could work with inside a single site collection. You could aggregate lists and libraries within that site collection and display them centrally. And that's what this product does. But at the time when we launched the Lightning Conductor, that was also in 2007, we were able to span multiple site collections. So the reason for that was if we had task lists, maybe in multiple different sites or document libraries in different sites and so on, we don't want to be looking for that content that we may not even know exists. So we're not going to be navigating from site to site just in case somebody may have created a task and assigned it to us, or you know, we're not going to necessarily know to have a look for a particular type of document before we create that document and so on. So the idea here is that you have a centralized hub of information, and that information is relevant to you, and it doesn't nowadays have to be SharePoint lists and libraries. It can be other apps as well, as I mentioned a moment ago, and we'll be getting into some of that. But even today, when we've got different places for storing documents, it's not just document libraries sprawled across lots of different sites inside of SharePoint or site collections inside of SharePoint. We can also have documents that may appear in my OneDrive or my business OneDrive and so on as well. So remembering where we may have created a document or when we last checked out a document, that sort of thing can be tricky. We overlook such things. And likewise with things like tasks, they may appear in task lists. They may also appear in planner or maybe to do. Events are the same thing. You've got events lists, but you've also got Outlook events and so on. So it's not easy to keep track of where we created this information, let alone the information that other people created for us. So the idea here is that everything we really need, we can set the scope, we can aggregate that content and have it to hand whenever we need it. It's not recreating that content, it's not creating a copy of it, it's just simply building views so that you can very easily access that content and therefore make quicker decisions, save time switching between different applications and searching for content when you can't remember where you created it. So that's really the purpose. The different things that we can aggregate. So as I mentioned, we've got lists and libraries. We've moved on from just site collections now. So every single site that we create inside of SharePoint, we can aggregate from, whether it's in a different site collection or not. If it's organized as a hub and an associated site, we can aggregate from them. We can also aggregate from SharePoint sites and content that is provisioned through a Microsoft 365 group. So if we create a new Microsoft 365 group through Outlook, we will get a library and so on. You get OneDrive, you get a planner and so on. We can aggregate from that information as well into the Lightning Conductor. So the idea is that we'll see all of that content in a single view, and we can even merge some of that content as well if we need to. But yeah, as I mentioned, there's also lots of other apps that come with Microsoft 365 nowadays. So we can also get to those without having to write any code. You can use the Microsoft Graph queries in order to do that. And we've built a lot of those queries for you. So what you're doing is really just pointing at the fact that you want Planner or you want OneDrive, whatever it might be. And then you can configure the view to be the way that you want it and to serve the information that you need to see. And then we also extend out to external graph connectors as well. So as I mentioned, if there's other applications that sit outside of Microsoft 365 that you also want to bring into SharePoint and build a view of that content, you can also do that. As I mentioned, Salesforce is an example, Jira is another one. There's quite a handful that Microsoft give you already inside of the Microsoft 365 Admin Center, but you can also create custom ones. So even if you've got something that is custom built, you could still aggregate that content using the Lightning Conductor if you've got the custom connector established. There's lots of different ways also, or four different ways of displaying the content. So there's something called the grid view, which is kind of like the default way of doing things. If you imagine what a SharePoint list view looks like, that's really what the grid view looks like inside the Lightning Conductor. So we can go through and select different columns that we want to see from the data that we're aggregating. You can apply all of your conditional formatting and data formatting. You can do grouping, and you can also add some calculated columns and things like that as well. So you can really see the information that you need to see. We've also got some JSON views. So if you are handy at writing JSON, you can actually build your own templates. But we've also provided some templates as well. So you'll see some of these today. We've got things like a calendar view. So if you want to aggregate from Outlook events or event lists or wherever else you might have events, you can display them inside a calendar view. And again, you could merge some of those so they're all appearing inside the same calendar. So that's something we can achieve with that. There's also a tile view for documents. We've got picture galleries, and there's some new ones that we're gonna be announcing today as well. There's XSLT, which is really for those of you that have been using the Lightning Conductor for quite some time. So you'll find some different views there that you can use. I wouldn't really set out and use the XSLT today. And then over on the right-hand side, we've also got some adaptive card views. Now, the nice thing about this one is, if you want to build yourself something unique, something custom, but you don't have JSON skills in-house, then adaptive cards could be your answer. You can use the Microsoft Adaptive Card Designer. You can build a view that you want, and you can simply copy-paste the JSON into the Lightning Conductor and use that view. So you do get a sort of WYSIWYG editor with the Microsoft Adaptive Card Designer. So you can build a view with that. And again, we also provide some that you can just go ahead and use or customize further if you want to. So you can use the Lightning Conductor in multiple places. The most common place to use it is inside of a SharePoint site. So if we're accessing maybe a site that's for our department of sales or human resources or whatever it might be, and we've got lots of subsites or we've got other site collections, then what we can do is aggregate that content into a single view. So a good example would be you might have a sales team site and a marketing team site, and quite often the marketing content is required inside the sales team. So rather than duplicating it or storing multiple copies of it, you could simply aggregate that content across the two different sites and have access to it that way. But that could also have multiple child sites, like maybe you've got social channels and things like that that are managed through through SharePoint sites that you can aggregate all of that content through. So you could also use it inside of Teams. So any team that you're using, you've got your channels with inside those teams, and you can add the Lightning Conductor as a Teams channel tab. So that's great. If you happen to be spending most of your time inside of Microsoft Teams, we can bring in our OneDrive files, our document libraries that we're quite often working with, but also things like Planner and what have you as well, into that Teams environment, so we can access that content quickly. And then we also extend that to Viva connections. So if you want to use one of the Lightning Conductor Viva adaptive cards, you can point that at a pre-configured view inside the Lightning Conductor web part. And that means that when we're on our mobile device or when we're going onto the Viva connections homepage, you'll be able to see the simple adaptive cards with some key information. So it might be that you've got 6 outstanding tasks or something like that. So it's bringing your attention to it, and you can then jump in and view that content. So that's pretty much it for slides. We're going to jump in and have mostly demo for the next 45 minutes. We will have some time for questions and answers as well. So if you do have any questions that you're thinking about, please make a note of them towards the end. We'll open up a Q&A. Feel free, if you want to, just drop it in the Q&A. I'll try and ignore that until we get to the end. But also, I've got a few colleagues on here that may be able to answer those questions as well. So first demo we're going to take a look at is mainly SharePoint based. So we're going to dive into a SharePoint site. We're then going to add the Lightning Conductor. It's going to be unconfigured. You're going to see how we can configure some more sort of common scenarios, so documents and things like that. We'll also aggregate some events. And I'm also going to combine another web part, which is the filter web part, so you can see how we can build out some dynamic filters with the Lightning Conductor as well. We'll dive in and take a look at that. So hopefully you're seeing my SharePoint site, and what we're going to do first of all is just build out a new page. So you can see plenty of my page. I'm just going to click on to add a page here inside this communication site here. We're going to start off with a blank page, and we'll just call this Lightning Conductor webinar demo, just so it's got a nice name. And we'll add the Lightning Conductor web part. So here's the Lightning Conductor. It's under my frequently used web parts, but if it's not there for you, then you just have to scroll down or search for it. So we've got a single Lightning Conductor on the page. Obviously, this is taking up quite a bit of space, but this will work within the sections that you create. So of course, if you had different column layouts on your SharePoint page in different backgrounds, it's going to adhere to that. It's fully responsive, so it will fit into those columns that you define. And we can create multiple views of content inside the same web part instance. So if it is the case that I want to see things like Microsoft to-do tasks, as well as task lists and also planner tasks in one web part instance, that's something that I can accomplish. And I could also merge those views as well if I want to. Now, when we hit the configure button inside the Lightning Conductor, it takes us immediately into the quick configuration. The reason for this is there are a lot of settings with inside the Lightning Conductor, and a lot of our customers really are doing things that are fairly generic. So things like document library rollups and picture rollups and things like that. So all of those quite common things to do are all here inside the quick configuration, and you'll find that a lot of the views are already built for you, but then you can go on and customize them in a nice, easy way. If you know what you're doing, and you've got some specific requirements, then you can jump into the advanced mode. And in there, we're going to see some more technical language, such as how do we aggregate the content and how do we display the content and so on. Still quite self-explanatory as you go through it. But this is where you can be very specific about the type of content that you want to look at. Now, you'll notice on the right-hand side also, I've got a title for a view. So currently it's just saying default. We'll go through and name that shortly. And we'll also add some multiple views inside the same web part instance. So we're going to start off with documents. And in fact, I'm going to do something first that I mentioned. I'm going to split this into one third left and one third right and two thirds left. So I've got one lightning conductor on the left-hand side, and I'm going to shortly add another lightning conductor over on the right-hand side. And you'll see why, because this one here, we're going to use that quick configuration to bring in all of the documents within inside a certain scope. And the scope is going to be the current hub site and any associated sites with it. Now, when I'm aggregating that content, you'll notice that these first five options don't say search engine next to them. These are going to be real-time queries of the content. So if we know that we've got a lot of documents and we're talking thousands of documents that we're going to be aggregating, it would be recommended to use one of the search options. You won't see any difference in the end result in the lightning conductor. It would just be a lot faster, but it won't be real-time, meaning that if somebody was to delete a document or change it in any way, that change isn't going to be reflected until the search index next kicks in. So we're going to do a real-time one. I'm going to choose the current site and associated sites. And you'll notice in there, I've got a choice of two ways of displaying it. So the grid view is the one that I mentioned that looks like a SharePoint list or a library. The tile view is, of course, specific to documents. This is going to render my folders and my files in a tile fashion so that you can sort of get a preview of what each of those look like. We can display person avatars. This is optional for those of you that might be wanting to use this in SharePoint on-premises. You can, of course, not have avatars showing. I'm going to display them here. And I'm also going to check this box as well, which is an option specific to document library aggregation. And that's going to allow me to preview the document in another instance, which is why I added these two columns. So if I just hit save, we'll see the content aggregating. So you'll notice in here that it's brought back that content. We do have the person avatar, so we can see who the created by was, or who the last modifier was, and so on. We've also got the title, we've got the document icons. And unlike a lot of aggregation tools, you'll notice that I can also expand collapse folders as well. So it doesn't just flatten out that hierarchy. We can flatten out hierarchy if you want to, but sometimes it's useful to actually see that content organized in the way that it's intended. So that's the first one. We'll get in and customize this in just a moment. But what I'm going to do over on the right-hand side is add another lightning conductor. So we've got another instance here, and I'm going to hit configure on that one. And this time, almost the same options, except for this one here, where we've got the drop down of how do you want to refine the view. So I've got things like show all the documents, or just show my documents, show all the documents that checked out to me, or this one, which is show the actual document from another lightning conductor. So that's the one that I'm going to check here, and we'll just hit save. And as you can see, it's not really doing much at the moment until in the first web part instance, I go through and select a file. And upon selecting that file, we get the preview. So we can now go through and see that content inside the web part before we get to open it or do whatever else we want to do with it. So hardly any configuration to accomplish that. I know you have the document preview inside of SharePoint natively that will work with document libraries, but this is working with aggregated content. So these documents are not just coming from this site, but they're coming from throughout the SharePoint hub. That could also come from cross-site collections and so on as well. Now, in the view here, we can simply hit the drop-down to apply filters. Because I'm still in edit mode on the page, I can also get into customizing this view. So some of the things that I might want to do, for example, make it look a bit tidier. I don't necessarily need to see the date and the time on this this modified column. So whilst we're still in edit mode, we can configure each of the columns. So what I'm going to do here is just bring that down to show a short date instead of the long date. So when we save that, it just looks a little bit neater in terms of the date format. And we could, of course, go ahead and do the same thing for this one. So let's just bring that down to the short date. If you've got any custom dates, you can actually overwrite that as well with your own custom date format. Okay, so we've applied a little bit of formatting there. We could also do conditional formatting and grouping and so on and so forth. Now we could filter on any of the columns. If I hit the filter, you'll notice that I could filter by a specific name. So if I wanted to filter by a person, I could do that. Or I could filter by the current user by ticking this checkbox. Or we can also connect to something else to get the filterable value. And that's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to add another web part. And this is known as the Lightning Filters that works with two of our products. It'll work with the Lightning Conductor and it'll also work with the Data Viewer. And you'll notice that we've got this ability to slide this bar. And that's because it's a number filter. But in the top right here, you'll notice that there's all sorts of different types of filters that we can apply. So I'm going to choose a people filter, have this default to the current user. So notice it's put my account name in there already, and we can change the text to be more meaningful to say something like choose a person. So that becomes the label for that web part. And then here inside the Lightning Conductor, I can go in and configure the created by column to connect to the choose a person web part. So by selecting that, I can then say I want the title property of the person that I specify. And now we've got a very dynamic way of displaying the content. So it's recreating that data. You can see that everything that it's filtered has been created by the Lightning Tools account. If I was to remove that and use the people picker to put Sandy in there, perhaps it's now going to have a look at all of the files that Sandy created and so on. So we've got three web parts here all working together to display quite a powerful solution when we're aggregating content. So that's one scenario. Obviously that's working with document libraries. So I'm going to get back to the Lightning Conductor here and bring up the properties for that one. We'll name our view. So let's call this documents or documents from the hub or whatever we want to name it. And then we'll add another new view in here as well. And what I'm going to bring in is some events this time. So we'll click onto the cog and you'll notice in the drop down here, we've got event lists that we can choose from. We've also got Outlook events as well. So I'm just going to go with the events list. Now, because this is a slightly different type of data source, you'll notice there's three other different types of views that have already been created with some filters in place. So we can see all the birthdays, all the meetings, or just all of the events. Again, we get to choose our scope and we then get to display it in multiple ways. And one of those ways is a calendar. So this is a JSON view, which we can select. And as I choose the events view here, you'll notice that it renders a calendar and we can see that we've got the North American Collaboration Summit coming up and we've also got the Microsoft 365 conference coming up as well. And you can, of course, this has got different ways of viewing the content. You've got day, week and month view. It's fully responsive. And if we go into the properties again under the display, we can also get into some of the conditional formatting and set other configurations through those properties as well. So under the conditional formatting, for example, you'll see that there's three conditions already set. It's looking for meetings, holidays and birthdays and then applying those in a different color if those categories are met. And you don't have to go with category. You can go with any metadata that is being served and set your own color formatting and so on. So you've got the color picker there where you can go through and apply that. It also doesn't have to work with events lists. So any custom list that you've created that has a start date and an end date, you could display inside the calendar. You could even display tasks inside a calendar since they often have a start date and a due date. So you could have a look at how those are going to fit inside your calendar as well. Okay, so that's an events calendar. if we also go through and create another one, let's just drop in here an Outlook events. We could do that. So this is now actually not a SharePoint list or library. This is coming from Microsoft Outlook, and behind the scenes, it's using the Microsoft Graph in order to be able to get to that content. So you can see here, it's again got some pre-configured views that we could change, and it's using the graph to get to that content. And there's again the three different styles that we can select from. So if I just choose the calendar again, we've now got Outlook events as well as event lists being aggregated. And yeah, we can see there's a few more of those that are being displayed inside of that calendar. Okay, if you wanted to merge those two calendars, by the way, that's also something that you could do. So I could add another new view. So this could be merged calendars. And when we configure that one, we'd need the advanced mode for this, but I can merge the views. So by selecting that one and then going to the data source tab, we would say, I want to merge these two. And we could then display the results of that inside one calendar, as opposed to having the two separate calendars. So that's another feature that we've got as well that is very, very powerful. Okay, so that's some of the quick configuration. We're going to get more into the advanced configuration shortly. Before we get onto that, we'll just have a look at how you might use this, not necessarily just in a SharePoint page as I'm doing here, but maybe on the homepage of your intranet. So if you're using maybe Viva connections, or if you've got a custom intranet solution as well from an intranet provider, you could also use the Lightning Conductor there to really bring in some useful content onto the homepage, perhaps of that view. So what we're going to do is just go in and edit the homepage here of this this particular site. So this is a communication site, and we're then going to add the Lightning Conductor to it. And when I go to configure, I'm going to show you one of the new features that we're pushing out, and that is to aggregate news. Now you might wonder why we're doing this, because Microsoft already does a great job of aggregating news to their sites, but this is more about aggregating larger scopes, also getting real-time results displayed, or also working with any custom properties that you've created as well inside your news articles. So in here, using the quick configuration, I'm able to select news. We can choose where we're bringing that news from. So again, we've got the hub and the associated sites, but equally I could go across the entire tenant if I want to via search and bring back quite a lot of news, and then filter that out based on relevance or something along those lines. So I'm going to go with the current site and associated sites. I'll show you the carousel view first of all. And you'll notice here we've got some news being aggregated. So we've got the Microsoft 365 conference coming up in Orlando, and we can scroll through that and see each of those different news articles. Now you might want to get rid of the command bar at the top, because when we're on the homepage of a communication site, we really want that to look slick. So we could go through and hide all of that. But what I'm gonna do is go into the properties as well. And what you'll notice under the display of the advanced configuration here is we can do things like make the change dynamic. So I'm gonna have this rotate through the news every 4 seconds. You can also change all of these sections of the news where that information is coming from. So the description column, if you've got a custom column that you want the description value to come from, you can just simply map it here. Likewise with the title column and the news URL column. So we're just basically mapping the columns to whatever we want. So if you created like custom content types around your news or anything like that and added fields to it, this is where you can bring that information into the view without actually having to go in and modify any JSON. Okay, so if we save that one, that should automatically rotate. Let's just get rid of that cancel button as well. So yeah, you can see, here's my hands, I'm not clicking my mouse, and that's rotating through each of those different news articles. Displaying nicely on the page. So on the right hand side, I'm going to add another instance of the Lightning Conductor, and we'll configure that again for the same. We're going to go with news, and we'll have all news coming in from the hub again, but this time we'll have a list view of that news. And once again, we could hide all of the command bar options, so it looks a bit slicker on that page. And this is just another format. And once more, you could map all of those properties, so you're seeing the relevant information that you want to see with inside that view. So if we republish this, hopefully you'll see that that looks quite nice on an intranet page. We're getting that content displayed quite nicely. Okay, so that's how we can work with SharePoint sites, also working with the communication sites or intranets. Let's take a look at Teams and how we can bring some information in there. I'm not just going to do the same aggregation. We're going to build on this and show you different types of content that we can aggregate with inside of the Lightning Conductor. So the things I'm about to show you are not Teams specific. It's just that we're aggregating them into Microsoft Teams. But you could do the same thing into SharePoint if you wanted to as well. So we'll jump into the Teams environment. So you can add the Lightning Conductor to any channel. So we can simply add the Lightning Conductor here. Equally, you could add a page that has a Lightning Conductor on it. So it depends what you want to do, but this is just quite a useful thing to do. We can go through and add the tab so we can then see our aggregated documents or our tasks or whatever we want to see just by selecting this tab here. Microsoft has made some nice changes recently where you do actually get to see the site by default. So notice we can go there and actually see the underlying SharePoint site, which is a good thing to see if you need to. All right, so I'm gonna go in and configure this one. And quite a common thing to want to do is bring in planner plans. Now there is actually already a planner tab that you can add. But again, the benefit here is that we can choose the scope of where we want those plans to come from. So again, we could do this with a quick configuration. I'm just gonna jump down here to planner plans and we'll select all the planner plans. It's using Microsoft Graph. We don't have a choice over that. We can either have those in the grid view where you can define all of your own formatting and your own conditional formatting and so on, or we've got another JSON file that we've created called the task view. So if I choose that task view, notice how we've got all of those planner plans available in the dropdown here. And then we've also got all of the tasks for those plans displayed. And this is dynamic. So if we want to click in here and maybe remove people from those, we can do that. We can also add additional people. We can mark them as complete. We can add new plans or new tasks to the plans and so on. And we can go in and name this. So we'll call this planner tasks. And we could then also bring in things like Microsoft to-do tasks as well. By selecting the to-do lists, we could also have those in a grid view. So I now have Microsoft to-do looking the same as my planner tasks, but I'm starting to see all of my tasks in one place. And of course, we've got the same thing with task lists. So hard to find nowadays with new Microsoft lists, but they still exist. So I can go through and choose those, again, choose the scope, and we can have those appearing in one of three different ways. I'll go with the grid view. And so you'll now see that we've got task lists coming in, as well as those to-do tasks and those planner tasks all in that one view. And again, I could merge those. So if I wanted to merge those three into one view, we could do that as well. So you're not having to chop and change. Now, there's also some useful views that are quite specific to Teams. One of the things that is sometimes tricky is the fact that in each team, you do have the ability to add events, so channel events and so on, channel meetings and so on. So if we want to aggregate those from multiple teams or multiple channels, we could use the Lightning Conductor for that. So I'm just going to go in and create a new view here called events. And we're going to this time bypass the quick configuration and go to the advanced mode. So here in the advanced mode, you'll notice that there's different ways of aggregating the content. We we're using some of these already in a quick configuration. We just hid the language from you. So in here, we've got the search role provider. And just to give you a quick view of this, you would configure a search query. So you can use any of the built-in search results to get to your content via that. We've also got the object model aggregation. So this is all about SharePoint sites and aggregating the different lists or libraries. So you can choose where you want that content to come from, the type of list or library that it is, and if there's any content types involved, and so on. We also have the graph rollup provider. So this is where you will tell it what type of graph entity you want to work with. If I was to choose one of those, like the planner, we then get to add our graph query, which could be one of our predefined ones, or you can also create a custom graph query and get to the content that way. And then there's also the Microsoft 365 group rollup provider, which I'm actually going to use here. And with that, notice that we can select from the Microsoft 365 groups and get to its content, or we could do the same thing through Teams, which is what I want to do here. So I'm going to choose the bottom option that allows me to select something like the sales team, and I'm just going to come down to marketing as well. So I've chosen sales and marketing. At the bottom here, we can choose my entity type. So with that, I've got events, if I wanted to use that one. We can then customize the query around that. We can choose the different types of columns and build out a view, or again, we've got a built-in JSON view, which I could select. So if I choose the JSON view, you'll notice that there's several different JSON views in here, and one of them is called the Outlook Events Agenda, which I'm going to use. And as I select that, you'll notice that when we choose events, we've got this agenda view of all those events going across those two different teams and all the channels within inside those teams. So we start to see those events all in the one view. Okay, so that's something that's sort of fairly specific to Teams, which is quite a nice one. I mentioned this, so I'm sure, and that is you could also bring in things like OneDrive files as well. So what we'll do here is we'll click onto the plus, and let's just name this OneDrive. And what I'm going to do is just click onto the cog icon. And from the quick configuration, we can actually do this. So what I'm going to do is go down here and choose the drive items option. And notice there's either my drive items or items shared with me. So I'm going to choose the my drive items option. And we've also got that grid view that we can use as well. So as I hit save, you'll notice here that we've now got the ability to go through and choose the OneDrive option. And of course, we could apply some conditional formatting and sorting and things like that to this view as well. Now, the final one before we move into Microsoft Viva connections, I'm going to show you how we can also aggregate from external graph connectors. So I'm going to go through and create a view here called Jira Issues. And so we use Jira internally. Our tech support team are able to raise issues that require fixing from the development team. What we can do is go through and connect to that as an external data source, so completely outside of Microsoft 365, and bring those Jira issues into Teams, where we've got that ability to view them without having to switch applications and so on. So we can't do the external connectors from the quick configuration, but what we can do is jump here into the advanced mode. And on the web part tab, I'm going to come down here to the graph connectors rollup engine provider, and we'll just let that authenticate. There we go. And what we can then do is either choose a grid view, which I'm going to do initially, and we'll then change to the JSON or adaptive card view. And then I'm going to go to the data source tab. And it's on the data source tab where these are just pre-configured. And they're pre-configured in Microsoft 365 Search Admin. So you'll find them in there. You'll be able to connect to all sorts of different things that Microsoft already allow you to do. But also, if you have anything that's kind of out of the ordinary, then you can also connect to those as well using a custom external graph connector. Yeah, you can see in here I've got a few things like intranet sites. I've got Jira, also Salesforce, and SQL. What I'm going to do here is just choose my Jira demo option. So we'll select that. We can, if we want to, apply a query string. We can set item limits and so on. And then as we go through to the columns page, this is going to load the available columns coming in from that JIRA issues view. So I could go through and select all. We can also make things sortable and filterable if we want to. And under the display tab is where we can go through and apply the display formatting and column aliases and things like that too. So you'll notice in here, I've got all of the columns shown. We might want to spend some time on this and format things like the created date as a short date and so on and so forth. I'm just going to leave this as it is. We will set the number of items per page to bring back. So I'll just choose 25 on that one. And we've also got things like sticky headers and so on that we can do. And we'll hit save. And so what you'll notice now, as I hit the drop down and choose the JIRA issues, we've got those JIRA issues coming through. And as I mentioned, we can do things like grouping them. So I could go through and choose the group by option on the person who reported the issue. We can also sort them, filter them, and so on and so forth. All right, so that's the sort of thing that you can do here. Of course, in Teams or in SharePoint, it doesn't matter. Just to point out one thing that I've overlooked so far, and that is with the columns tab in the advanced mode, you can also add calculated columns as well. And this could be just simple calculations between existing columns. You could also do concatenations and things like that between things like first name and last name to make a full name column and so on. So all of the columns that are within inside the data source that you're connected to are all available here, and you can string them together. Or you can also use some of our predefined ones. And on the JIRA example here, there's just that option to merge columns. So I could go through and choose that. And we've got lots of things that are very helpful for you. But just to point out that that's the sort of thing that you could do. We've also got for things like SharePoint lists, lots of other options as well that you can add as a calculated column. All right, so let's switch back now to our SharePoint environment. So back away from Teams for a moment, and we're going to go onto that page that we started off on, which was the Lightning Conductor webinar demo page. And you will notice in here, again, we've got the views that we created earlier, things like the documents from the hub, the events, and also Outlook events. So what we're going to do is just start to add to this one a little bit with some more advanced configurations. And I'm also going to show you some adaptive cards as well using the Lightning Conductor. Okay, so the first thing we'll do, I just do want to point out that if you are aggregating from some data sources like this one that we created, which is aggregating in real time the documents from the current hub site and associated sites, one thing to bear in mind is this might start off really, really well, where we've got some great views being loaded in a timely fashion. But as those document libraries begin to grow, one of the things you might want to do is switch it to search so that we can bring back that content a lot faster. Now, to make that easier for you, what we can do is actually use the wizard. So if I go into the Lightning Conductor here, we can bring up the properties for this web part. And on the documents from the hub, which if we go into the advanced mode on that one, you'll notice that it's using the object model to aggregate. It's not using the search. But here's that option where we can go through and convert it to use search instead. So it's given me a few warnings in here about certain document column types might not map and so on, but it gives me the option to map those. If I just hit continue and create the view, it will actually go through and create a brand new view for me. So you'll notice here that we're now bringing back that content a lot quicker via search. And just to show you the sort of performance that you can expect from that, I'm going to choose this tenant documents, which you wouldn't really want to do. I just want to do it here to show you. So if I choose documents and we'll bring them back using the search engine, again, we could display things like avatars and document preview and things like that if we want to. But just notice if I choose the tenant documents option that we've actually got 184 pages worth of documents returned almost immediately that we can now start to navigate through. And of course, you can filter and so on and so forth with that one. All right, so we've got some good views here created. What I do want to do is just show you some of the different adaptive card options. So there's two things that we can do here. One of them, if we just jump back to Teams for a moment, we've got the Jira issues that I showed with the grid view. What I can do is change the display provider to an adaptive card display provider. And what that gives me, if we come down to the display, is the ability to take some sample data from our aggregation. So this is showing one of those issues that were created in Jira. And then down here, I could create some JSON. So you don't want to really be doing that. So what you have got here is also the adaptive card designer by Microsoft. So if I open this up in a new tab, you'll notice the adaptive card designer loading. And with this, we've got a visual way of going through and creating an adaptive card view. It came with an example. I can hit the new card and it gives me lots of other examples. So if there's any of these that we want to work with, we can. But what we can also do is just simply take the content, so sample input data, and drop that in here over on the right hand side. So let me just deselect that. Let's try and copy that one more time. There was a time where copy and paste always used to work. All right, let's just copy that onto the clipboard manually then and paste that in here. There we go. So we've got our sample data. We can start to build this. And then once we've built it, we can take the payload editor here and its content and drop that into the Lightning Conductor. And that will give us that view as you saw inside the adaptive card designer. The good news is you don't have to do that either if you're using external connectors. I can just say use the card from the data source. So you actually do get a JSON adaptive card view created when you create your external connector inside of Microsoft 365 admin. You can make some amendments to that view through here. So I can allow these to be sortable and filterable and so on. I've also got the pagination and what have you. So now when we save that, notice how we've got this nice JSON view, and I can choose the created column because I made that sortable. I can sort by it and so on. And we've got that great view there. So that's just one example. But what we can also do with the adaptive cards, if we want to, is display adaptive cards inside of Viva Connections. So let's go into our Viva Connections dashboard, and I'll show you how we can bring that content straight to the user, whether they're using their mobile phone or whether they're using the desktop for this. So what I'm going to do first is just grab the URL to the page that I created, because what we're going to do is use this web part here to serve the adaptive cards on the Viva Connections dashboard. So if we've got that on the clipboard, it makes our life easier. We can now go to the homepage of my Viva Connections site, and we'll just wait for this to load. We should get the cog icon any moment now. There we go. And in here, we can go and manage our Viva Connections dashboard. So we'll hit that dashboard option. And you'll notice that I've got a few Viva cards already, but we're just going to go through and edit those. It will take me into the mobile view or the desktop view, and we can go in and add our card. So this is the card that I want to add, is the Lightning Conductor card. We can go into the properties of that. We can make it a large card or a medium card. We can choose our own icon for it. We can give it a title. So I'm going to call this Jira Issues and paste in the URL. In fact, that one's not going to work because that was in Teams. Sorry, beg your pardon. Let's just go with documents. So I'll just call this one documents. We've pasted in the URL, and then we can choose the instance of the Lightning Conductor on that page. And we can choose the view that we want to display. So notice these are the views that we created. We've got the tenant documents that you just saw me create, the documents from the hub search, that's one that we used the wizard for. We've got events and Outlook events, and then we've also got documents from the hub as well, which is the real-time aggregation. And then we can choose the columns that we want to show. So I can select the name, maybe who it's created by. We could have the parent list title or something like that, so we know where it is. We can customize this message. So it says you have placeholder retrieved items. So we could have that read documents. It could be you've got 10 checked out documents or whatever you want that to read. And then we've also got the buttons that we can display, the number of items we want to show in a quick view. We can change the text on our previous and next button and things like that. And as we republish this, you'll notice that that is now retrieving those documents. So currently it says zero documents. That's not technically correct. But hopefully that will refresh in the moment and show us that actually how many documents we have. And that can, again, show up on the mobile view or on the desktop view. And it just gives users a bit of a heads up as to what's going on in a simple fashion. And then they can drill into that information in a bit more depth if they want to. So that's where the card will live. And that can show your aggregated content. I will just call out some of those new features as well. So under the 6.3 that we're releasing this month, we had those brand new news aggregation views. So the carousel and the list. We've also added news to the quick configuration, and we defined those properties where you can go through and customize the news views as well. And finally, we've improved the responsive design of the calendar layout as well. All right, so if there is any questions, feel free to ask them. Otherwise, feel free to also reach out to us by using email, so you can contact us on help@lightningtools.com. All right, many thanks.